When I finally got this IBM PC AT a few weeks ago, I also received this boxed copy of Windows 386 along with it. Of course, this one here won't run on it, but its near identical sibling, Windows 286, will do. Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the vintage collector, and these are my stories. When Windows 2.0 was released in December 1987, it was far away yet from commercial breakthrough. It is said that by 1990, only roughly 2 million copies of Microsoft Windows had been sold since the original release in 1985. That was accounted to be 5% of the globally deployed 40 million personal computers at the time. Only Windows 3.0 would see commercial success, selling 2 million copies alone within 6 months of its release.
How much do you think this advanced operating environment is worth? Wait just 1 minute before you answer. Watch as Windows integrates Lotus 1-2-3 with Miami Vice.
Of course, this was not only due to a huge marketing campaign by Microsoft, but also because computers had become more powerful by 1990. The 386 had definitely arrived in the mainstream, being gradually replaced by the more powerful 486 released a year prior. Machines were seeing better graphics support and larger base memory configurations, which helped to propel the graphical UI on the PC. Furthermore, Microsoft had continuously invested into improving Windows over the years. While the initial version of Windows 1.0 was received as a dull release, not being able to compete with Apple's system software, furtherly being too resource demanding at the time of its release in 1985, Windows 2.x did somewhat better. Not being a critical success either, Windows 2.0 had an improved GUI supporting overlapping windows, desktop icons, keyboard shortcuts, and VGA graphics support. The newly introduced overlapping windows were a source of a legal dispute between Apple and Microsoft, which eventually was lost by Apple. With release 2.1, Windows saw a dedicated release for the Intel 8386 CPU running on a protector mode kernel, also supporting the virtual 8086 mode to run multiple concurrent DOS applications and EMS emulation to overcome the 640 KB memory limit. Consequently, this release was sold as Windows 386 for $199, which is equivalent to $540 in 2025. The less capable Windows 286, which despite its namesake also ran just fine on 8086 and 8088 CPUs, was sold for $99. Microsoft knew that Windows would only become a success with a large base of critical business applications. And Microsoft had some in their portfolio that still exists today, Word and Excel. Excel dates back to as early as 1985 when it was first released for the Macintosh to quite some success. Originally conceived as a successor to their earlier spreadsheet application Multiplan, which couldn't compete with the then predominant Lotus 1-2-3, Excel ultimately also saw a release for Windows 2.0 by 1987. Said that, Microsoft could not assume everyone to have Windows already at hand, so they did something rather clever. They simply bundled a trimmed-down runtime version of Windows alongside Microsoft Excel and sold it for $159. So before we will be looking at Windows 286 on the AT, I ran an install in 86box, albeit in three different configurations. In my previous episode, I had shown you how I retrofitted the Hercules and CGA adapters to my IBM PC, XT and the AT respectively. While I do have an EGA adapter, I don't have a matching CRT display for the PC AT, so we'll only get to see Windows 286 in its EGA graphics mode later on. With 86box, I can at least show you Microsoft Excel side by side for all three, Hercules, CGA and EGA graphics. This setup procedure differs only by the graphics driver selection. And this is what it looks like, with EGA presented in color, whereas Windows only appears in monochrome on the CGA display. Also, the Hercules graphics only support black and white, however, at a slightly better resolution than CGA. The Windows runtime leaves away pretty much all Windows functions, but provides only the bare minimum. Both Windows 1.x and 2.x didn't have the Program Manager yet, but the MS-DOS Executive, which we will see in a minute, but this wasn't included with the runtime. Instead, you'll find this Run option in the System menu, from which you can access the Clipboard, the Macro Translation and the Windows Control Panel. That's it. Also note that it won't ask you to end your Windows session when exiting Excel. As expected, Excel would also work seamlessly with the full version of Windows 286, which by default starts into said MS-DOS Executive, which is sort of a file browser interface. There's no program groups yet, so it's simply navigating into the desired program directory where Excel was installed to and run excel.exe directly from there. It would start right away into your Windows session and feels exactly the same way as when running from its self-contained runtime environment. As opposed to the runtime version, Windows 286 would ask to end the Windows session upon exit. Of course, Excel wasn't the only business application bundling the Windows runtime. AMI, which in later years was acquired by Lotus and later IBM, also known as AMI Pro in later years, was one of many applications bundled with the Windows runtime. Now, installing it on the IBM PC AT wouldn't be too complicated, except that I tripped myself into issues with the Logitech C7 mouse as seen in an earlier episode. During my investigation about the C7 mouse, I found this article here, which claimed that the C7 emulated a mouse system's mouse rather than a Microsoft mouse. With that in mind, I installed AMI with the mouse system's driver, only to find myself without a working mouse. So I thought to change the driver to a Microsoft mouse. But this was the times of non-plug and play. Things were less user-friendly 40 years ago, and so both the Windows 286 full version and the runtime version require full reinstall just to change the mouse driver. But even with the Microsoft mouse driver, it wouldn't work, so I tried a third time with the Logitech mouse driver. And yes, this seemed to work just fine.
Surprise! You were using the wrong mouse driver. What had you been expecting?
Well, going by this reading, one can assume that at the time of release of the C7 mouse, Logitech wasn't as well established as in later years, so they really went with the mouse system's protocol. It is furtherly mentioned that the C7 had dip switches on the inside, which allowed for changing the protocol. Now, as I anyway still had to replace the gliders for the mouse, I went to gently remove the seal with a heat gun in order to crack it open. And as I had thought already, there's no trace of dip switches. So apparently, the C7 mouse saw multiple revision changes since 1985 and was eventually changed to Logitech's own protocol and doing away with the need to tamper around with dip switches. Had I had an earlier revision of the C7 mouse, my approach would definitely have been the correct one. While in the years before, both spreadsheet and word processing happened on CLI-driven interfaces, applications like AMI had definitely the advantage of the what you see is what you get concept and helped to furtherly accelerate the acceptance of graphical GUIs. And GUIs definitely played out in favor for applications like CorelDRAW and Aldus PageMaker, later known as Adobe PageMaker. So bundling a stripped-down Windows runtime with business applications definitely helped to spread Windows into a market at a time when it simply was not yet a default install. And this ultimately resulted in broader market acceptance over time. Of course, even so, I didn't do any real work, but just playing around with it a bit. Running Windows 286 on the IBM AT definitely feels sluggish and slow and requires a lot of nostalgic patience. I don't think many people actually ran Windows on the IBM PC AT. A more powerful system, like the 1986 Compact Desk Pro 386, would definitely be more favorable in terms of speed. So what do you think about it? When did you start using graphical UIs on the PC? Or did you even witness the advent of Windows in its early days? Let me know in the comments below. And if you're enjoying this kind of deep dive into vintage systems and software, consider supporting the channel. Even a small monthly pledge really helps me keeping these systems running and making videos like this one possible. Supporters get early access, behind the scenes updates and a warm fuzzy feeling from helping me fighting ancient drivers, dead capacitors and stubborn software. I'm the Vintage Collector and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching and see you again next Sunday.